I'm Mary Dickson. I am a downwinder. Like countless other Americans, I grew up under the clouds of fallout from nuclear testing and later developed cancer. I lost my older sister to an autoimmune disease, and now my younger sister is battling a rare cancer. My life and work have been shaped by what happened to me and so many of the people I love at the hands of our own government, all in the guise of protecting us. Between 1951 and 1992, the US government exploded 935 nuclear bombs, each more powerful than those that leveled Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Those tests, conducted at the Nevada test site, put unsuspecting Americans in harm's way. When atmospheric testing was banned in 1962, the tests were moved underground. But many of those leaked, sometimes spewing towering mushroom clouds into the atmosphere. Radioactive fallout from four decades of nuclear testing left a devastating legacy across the entire continental United States. I carry this map in my wallet. It's from Richard Miller's book, Under the Cloud, The Decades of Nuclear Testing, and it shows where the winds carried radioactive fallout from the test site. Utah and Nevada are almost completely blacked out, and the black ink spreads as far east as New York and as far north as Canada. And the black blots out areas in the Midwest. Think about that. That's where much of our nation's food is grown. Radiation didn't respect arbitrary lines on a map. It was picked up by the jet stream and carried across the country. That's how it fell to the ground in rain and snow and worked its way into the food chain. That's how it reached and was measured in Salt Lake City, the Midwest, and upstate New York, 2,300 miles from the test site. There's another map I carry, one that's drawn by the scars on my body. The earth shifted for me in the spring before my 30th birthday when I was diagnosed with thyroid cancer, a cancer that's common in those exposed to fallout. My world lost its predictability in two words. It's malignant. In subsequent years, I had another surgery that was a possible result of radiation exposure. I grew up in Salt Lake City, drinking milk from a nearby dairy, eating fresh vegetables from the garden, mixing sugar with snow to pretend it was ice cream, and playing in puddles of rainwater. How were any of us to know that a silent poison was threading its way through our bodies when the government repeatedly assured us there is no danger? We blithely went about our lives, assuming all was well. We trusted a government that assured us we had nothing to fear. After I got sick, I started keeping a list of friends and neighbors who had cancer and autoimmune diseases. That list grew to 54 people who lived on the canyon's rim near my childhood home in Salt Lake City. Sometimes I feel like I'm forever piling up losses. Friends, coworkers, relatives, the allies I've worked with on this issue for decades. There is power in our stories. In 2007, I wrote a play called Exposed that ended with a somber reading of my list of the dead. After each performance, the cast asked the audience to add names of downwinders on a wall outside the theater. In just a few nights, so many names were added that we had no room left on the wall. What is hard for me to reconcile is that our government knew the facts about fallout and that they lied to us. We were deemed expendable, which is why it outrages me that this administration, which I doubt knows the staggering cost of our nuclear past, is considering resuming nuclear testing. And for what? There is no military purpose. We already possess the most powerful nuclear deterrent in the world. The Senate version of the National Defense Authorization Act includes $10 million to prepare for an explosive nuclear test. A Department of Defense official has said such a test could be conducted within months if ordered. Even considering a test is utterly immoral given what we know. And ironically, these discussions of resuming nuclear testing are coming at the same time that bills have been introduced in Congress to expand the very limited Radiation Exposure Compensation Act, which currently offers qualified downwinders in a small circle of rural Utah, Nevada, and Arizona counties only $50,000, and those funds are set to run out in 2021 unless expansion bills are passed. The expansion would include downwinders in the entire state of Utah and other states. We have waited far too long for justice. The story of nuclear testing and its consequences isn't included in American history books, and most Americans, including elected representatives, don't know this chapter of our history. This is one of the reasons I am so grateful that Cale Weston is running for Congress in my district. Not only is he a man of great integrity and intelligence, he understands this important issue from firsthand experience. His parents are downwinders. My hope is that those like Cale who understand the tragedy of nuclear weapons, that the demand that the mistakes of the past never be repeated, and that no government ever again sacrifices innocent civilians to nuclear weapons. If we learned anything from being the involuntary subjects of atomic testing, it is that we all live downwind.